Welcome to Crash Concepts, where the economy, energy, and the environment are explored. Up next, fresh ideas and insights into the factors that are driving the world and shaping your future. Presenting information you can't afford to live without, here's Chris Martinson.
Welcome to another Peak Prosperity Podcast. I am your host, of course, Chris Martinson, and today we are very pleased to welcome John Doody to the program. John is editor at goldstockanalyst.com and one of the best-known experts on gold mining stocks. While the price action in precious metals has been lackluster over the past year and a half, the mining stocks as an asset class have performed miserably. And in March of 2013, the Huey Gold Bugs Index sits at a lower spot than at any other time over the past 3 years. You'd be hard-pressed to find a more out-of-favor industry with investors at this time. Does this mean we should be walking away, or does this give us special opportunities? Now, I've invited John on to discuss why this is and whether these miners may now be poised for a strong rebound from here. And we're also going to talk about the recent developments in Cyprus and what they might portend for precious metals. John, thanks so much for taking the time to be with us today.
Hi, Chris. I'm glad to join you.
Fantastic. Well, let's start right at the top of this. Mining stocks traditionally act as leverage plays on the precious metals, but over recent years, they have not performed as one would have expected, given the upward march in gold and silver prices and the impact of QE on stocks in general. So, John, what are some of the reasons they've underperformed here?
Well, I think the first reason is that it's a misnomer over the last decade that stocks have underperformed bullion. The mining stocks are not a monolithic, all the same characterization. That they're, it's a stock picker's market, like most stock markets. And you can find good stocks that have done well, that have had growth and dividend growth, and production growth and share price growth. Over the last 12 years of this bull market, our stocks are up an average of 1,200%. And I would say that we're the only newsletter in the world that has an audited track record. So we hire an independent auditor to come in and look at our trades, which aren't that many, every year. So I'm not smoking something when I'm telling you that our track record is. But no question. I mean, that the average stock has not done well. And part of that's because a lot of decisions that were made by managements of the average stock who aren't there anymore. Barrick got rid of their top guy. Kinross got rid of their top guy. The top guy at Newmont has been eased out. And I think that companies are slowly getting the message, or maybe quickly now, that shareholders want returns to shareholders, not growth for growth's sakes alone. So that over the next few years, I think we're going to see the mining companies much more financially disciplined. And even in the last couple of years, we've seen them start paying dividends, which they never did before. Dividend was a waste of money as far as what they thought. But now you can find gold stocks yielding. I think Newmont's got a 4% yield. One we like, Goro, has got I think it's a 5 or 6% yield at the moment. So, and the typical gold stock is yielding somewhere in the 2 to 3% range. So, I think owning a gold stock with good growth prospects and disciplined growth prospects, and at a 2% or 3% yield, is a lot better than having your money in the savings bank for 0.2% yield.
Oh, absolutely. So let's talk about what some of the, let's say, financial prudence has been instilled in the mining sector. One of the things that bothered me personally as a mining stockholder for a while was share dilution. And another was what I thought was relatively weak cash flow from operations, given, you know, the expansion in the price of the metals. Are those a couple of examples of the things that you're tracking at goldstockanalyst.com when you do publish lists of, say, the top 10, top 50 companies? When you're looking at things, what are you really looking at in mining companies on a fundamental basis?
Well, that's what we do, is fundamental analysis. We're not momentum players or momentum investors. We track essentially 60 of the largest gold mining companies that are publicly traded, and these are all producers or near producers. We're basically number crunchers, and these are the companies you can get numbers from. You can't get exploration or numbers from an exploration company because all they've got is drill hole data, which doesn't mean much until you put it into a mining plan. And so that we track the mining companies and their data, and we look at basically how the market is valuing a company's ounces of reserves, how it's value, what's the market cap for ounce of reserves, what's the market cap for an ounce of production, and also what's the market capitalization multiple of the company's cash flow. So cash flow is basically the gold price minus the cash cost to produce an ounce. That gives you its the net margin that it makes per ounce. And we track that on a pretty tight basis, that we're interested in companies that can either have big cash flows now that are going to continue to grow them, or companies that will have growing cash flows as their expansion projects come into play. And we're very focused on companies not diluting their share base. We don't like companies to sell shares unless it's necessary. We prefer them to sell shares rather than hedge, for example. Everything's got a trade-off in life. But companies have finally gotten the message, and most acquisitions that were made in the last decade were made for shares, and these share payoffs didn't pay off. They issued a lot of shares, Kinross being one, issued over half the shares worth over half the value of the company and it was a $7 billion acquisition at the time. And now Kinross has written down over almost $4 billion of that acquisition because mining property, while it's an okay mining property, has not turned out to be the 1.5 million ounce a year potential producer that they thought when they bought it. It's probably going to end up being a 500,000 ounce a year producer. And that's a Tasiast deposit in Mauritania. So, you know, companies, and that costs the president his job. Companies are getting the message that they have to husband their shares in the same way that they husband their cash. And I think that over time, you know, with this change in philosophy in the industry, in this uniform, that investors will start seeing a payoff. And we're lucky now for new investors to the arena anyway, that they can get in when the stocks are down and it's looking like up from here as opposed to buying at the top and like buying at Apple at 700, for example, last September. And now, of course, Apple trades about 40% lower in the low 400s. We're at the Apple stage trading lower now, and for new investors coming into the market, there's plenty of upside that we see.
I do see that on the Huey Gold Bugs Index I mentioned before on the weekly, it's in oversold territory for the first time in a number of years, suggesting that, yeah, there might be a bottom here. Now, John, you mentioned a bunch of very interesting things in there. The first I'd like to maybe dig a little deeper in is you mentioned cash cost per ounce is something you track. I know in general mining costs have been going up across all the whole mining sector, not just gold and silver precious metal miners, but everywhere. What kind of trends are you seeing in the cash cost per ounce, understanding that that could be part inflation and also in some cases partly due to the fact that maybe ore qualities are not as high as they've been in the past?
Yeah, well, there's a couple of things that come into that. In the first place, it's traditional in the mining business when the gold prices are high, to the extent you can, and you often cannot do this very much, but you want to produce from your lower grade ounces then, because those ounces are profitable, and you want to save your higher grade ounces for the times when prices may not be so favorable. But you really can't change much more than 10% of your production profile. Because when you get, particularly in an open pit, where you basically have to mine everything there is in order to go deeper. But sometimes when you've got an underground mine, they can bypass an area where they know it's high grade to take a lower grade area. So in a sense, some of the rising costs is just probably it's a good business practice to use the low grade ounces that you could produce now when prices are high, because you're going to get a reasonable margin on them. And if the prices fall back, you've got the higher grade ounces that you can produce later. But just, you may be interested to know that on the 60 miners we track, the average cost for forecast cash cost an ounce of production for 2013 is $710. And the reality of it is that's not all. Because there's a number of costs that go into the any mining operation at the mine site that, like sustaining capital has to be invested and exploration that typically are not included in the cash cost of ounce of a mine, but they have to be incurred in order for the mine to continue on. So probably the real cash cost, to operate a mine is somewhere in the, $1,100, $1,200 an ounce, which is not much, as much of a margin as you might think. Given where the current gold price is. And the miners are slowly adapting what they call all-in cash cost accounting, because one of the problems you have as a miner is that you're operating in a country that might have some ability to change its royalties or its tax structure in a way to capture what they think are windfall profits that the miners are earning. Profits have been okay. They're not windfall because the way of reporting purely the cash cost per ounce, doesn't give any weight or any value for these other costs that have to be incurred to keep the mine operating. Otherwise, you'll just run out of ore. And so this all-in cash cost is an attempt by the industry to capture that. And we like generally miners that have a cash cost per ounce of under $400 an ounce. We like miners, and they don't all report this way yet, but we like miners that have an all-in cash cost of twice that, around $900 an ounce.
Well, that sounds perfectly reasonable. We see the same trend, obviously, in petroleum exploration companies. They can get a barrel out of the ground for X, but then it's X plus Y, meaning you have to get it to market, you got to refine it. There's all kinds of things that have to happen. So I'm glad to see that kind of all-in accounting is starting to take place here. And in terms of the hedging that you mentioned before, obviously that was a really big deal a number of years ago. Is the general trend that companies have certainly walked away from hedging to some extent, or are they mostly out of hedging?
They've all walked away. There's nobody hedging. Well, I shouldn't say nobody, but there's very, very, very few companies doing any hedging. But what they are doing is a different form of hedging, which is selling a stream of output for X number of dollars up front. They're selling a stream of output. And generally they do this on byproducts, so it's not so onerous. It's not like hedging the cost that you're gonna, or the price you're gonna get for your gold or your silver. If you're a gold miner, you might hedge or sell a stream of your silver production, and the same might be true if you're a base metal miner, selling a stream of your silver production. And that's been a big reason behind Silver Wheaton's success. So as long as the companies don't start selling off a portion of their gold production, if they're a gold miner, in the form of a stream, then they're pretty much, I think the market will accept it. But of course the old hedging, methodology was that you locked in the price of your output, your gold at some number, like $400 an ounce, and you figured you could produce at $250 an ounce and you'd have that cash margin as profit. But that caps the upside for the gold miner. And investors walked away from companies like that, and they've all learned that lesson not to do it.
Well, that takes a lot of the leverage right out of it. Then you're just pretty much just in a depleting industry. Your mine is depleting, and you can just have a cash basis, and you can just calculate all of that. It's more like a bond at that point, right?
Yeah, or more, you know, the Australians were always big hedgers, and for them, it was all about cash flow, and they couldn't have cared less whether they were mining gold or coal.
Right. Well, I'm certainly glad to hear that hedging is down, and so for the ancillary streams are doing what sound like forward sales. That sounds good. Who are they selling that to?
Well, the three major buyers are the royalty companies, Silver Wheaton. And the royalty company is a big company. Silver Wheaton's got a $20 billion market cap, and Franco-Nevada and Royal Gold. So they're basically companies that the latter two, Franco and Royal, started out investing money in companies that had an interesting prospect or project, and giving them money to do more drilling, more exploration, and they sort of grew into this almost a financing mechanism, where some of the big stream financings, like Franco just did a financing for a mine in Panama. They're going to put up $1 billion to get basically 100,000 ounces a year for forever, virtually, certainly forever. Anybody listening to this call, including us. Mm-hmm. At a price of $400 an ounce, and so it gives them pretty good leverage to the upside of the gold, and they're locked in at a price of $400, which gets a modest inflation adjustment over the years. But it gives them the upside on the gold. They're glad to do it because their partner is a copper miner, and $1 billion that they're putting in is financing 20% of building the mine.
And I assume that's secure as long as that copper mine continues to function.
That's right. The contract for the royalty is secured by the property, not by the company that's mining it.
Excellent, excellent. Well, so now that we've heard about companies getting a little more fiduciary responsibility and starting to shepherd their shareholders as carefully as they're shepherding their mine outputs, John, I think many are wondering if the miners, have they finally bottomed as an asset class, given how low sentiment is currently and with precious metals looking like they're bouncing off of recent lows. Do you agree? And if so, what do you foresee for the miners for the rest of the year?
Well, timing is always the hardest thing to predict in any kind of investments, because you can be, particularly when you want to buy something at a good price, so that often means you have to be early in order to catch some kind of a good price, and we believe in being early. Our time horizon is 2 to 3 years, not 2 to 3 months, as investors sometimes like to have. So one factor that we look at in valuations is, as I mentioned this earlier, is this concept of market cap per ounce. what's the market cap of the company, which is the number of shares times the price of the stock, divided by its P&P reserves, its proven and probable reserves, which are the only ounces the SEC lets a company talk about. Those are there to a greater certainty than other classifications of ounces. And the market cap for an ounce of gold reserves right now, this is off the front page of our latest issue of GSA Top 10, is $206 an ounce. At the low point in the market crash, when all the gold stocks fell and gold stocks, everything fell, the price per ounce was over double that. So the $206 an ounce is a number we haven't seen in this whole bull market since 2001, when gold itself only sold in the $200 an ounce. You know, we had valuations of an ounce that were higher than the current $206. So, you know, we think this is a pretty good indication that the market is really washed out. And if nothing else, investors, sophisticated investors, could start arbitraging this and buying companies that are selling with a low cash cost or low market cap per ounce of reserves and shorting the metal itself, that they could be arbitraging the difference. At some point, and three times in the last bull market in the last decade, an ounce of gold sold at 38% of the gold price. Right now, the $206 represent 13% of the gold price. So the difference between the 13% and the 38% peak that was reached three times in the past decade is an arbitrage. I don't think people are going to short gold, but I think it's a factor investors should look at, and thinking that even if the gold price remains the same or stabilizes in this area, there's plenty of opportunity for the valuations to increase.
So we're sitting at an all-time kind of low when we look at market cap divided by P plus P, proven and probable reserves. So 206 an ounce, that seems fundamentally low. Again, how many times have we hit this level in the past?
We hit three times in the last decade.
Three times. And what was the performance after that period of time over the next 2 to 3 years, which is your horizon?
Well, higher. You know, we're up 1,200% over the decade.
Right. Well, excellent. So in your you track 60 companies, and I assume you have them all organized in terms of some sort of a priority list. There's some you probably favor at the top. How would you recommend that people who want to have exposure to gold mining shares but don't currently, how would you recommend they go about doing that? Would that be in individual shares? Is there an index that you steer people towards? How does somebody get started?
No, we think that our performance beats every index, beats the XAU, beats the HUI, beats gold bullion itself, because we, in tracking these 60 stocks, we're able to identify companies that are undervalued versus their peers. And we think ultimately over time value will out. And the result of this 60-stock study is what we call our top 10, the Gold Stock Analyst Top 10. And we actually publish three newsletters. One covers all 60 stocks, and that's called GSA Pro, and that's geared more towards the investment advisor or investment professional. And most retail kind of investors aren't interested in the 50 stocks we cover but are not currently top 10. They only want to know about which ones we're recommending. And so the second publication is GSA Top 10, which talks about only those top 10 stocks. It's a little bit more written for the retail investor. And it's that top 10 portfolio that we tell people to buy equal weighting in all. The biggest mistake that gold stock investors make is they buy one, which is the absolute worst philosophy. And because this is a risky business, so stocks are volatile. Mother Nature is a risky mother to this whole thing. And the politics are risky. We avoid stocks in risky areas, but that doesn't mean you can't have risk. Some Indian tribe in Canada can make troubles for some mine up there, and people think about Canada as being relatively risk-free in mining. But there's always issues that can come up. So that the way that you minimize that risk is you diversify by owning 10 stocks. And in an era of internet trading and $7 transaction costs, the cost to own 10 stocks is pretty trivial. So, and that's how we've been able to establish our performance. It's, of course, we get some home runs out of that 10 all the time. Well, not all the time, but frequently. But we get lots of singles and doubles and triples. And it's that small ball baseball term that we find that gives us the track record that beats everybody. There's absolutely no mutual fund, no index, no bullion, no nothing. It can top our attitude track record. That's why we have a pretty big subscriber base.
Excellent. Well, I assume that the South African mining troubles that recently were all over the news did not affect anything in your universe at this point?
No, we're not. We have recommended South Africans in the past, but they're probably going to ultimately nationalize the mines. We follow the stocks, but we don't recommend them.
Okay, got it. So let's talk about what's on a lot of people's minds these days, the recent developments in Cyprus. It's really hard to see the move there as anything other than a new chapter in fiat wealth confiscation, or just wealth confiscation in general, which should drive demand, you would think, for physical precious metal. What implications do you anticipate this will have for metals and then the miners?
Well, I think it's on balance positive, but I don't think it's going to be the driver of the last resort that's really going to set everything on fire. I mean, if you're in Europe, you can always put your money in Switzerland or in Germany and nations that don't have that same problem that Cyprus had. I think the direction, the reason that Cyprus is a big money haven for Russian oligarchs, and where they've taken ill-gotten gains off in one way or another, they're usually ill-gotten in Russia, and put the money offshore in Cyprus. And the Germans, you know, basically the power behind the ECB, are not going to bail out the Russians. You know, Russia split the company in half and controlled East Germany for decades, and I don't think the Germans have a lot of sympathy with the Russians, and if they've got to pay more for the cost of their transgressions, if they're just giving up ill-gotten gains for the most part. And now I think Cyprus is between a rock and a hard place because the Russians have loaned them over $3 billion, I forget whether it's dollars or euro, but big number anyway. And Putin's not happy when all of his buddies are getting a haircut on their money. The biggest mistake, in my opinion, that was made in all of this is that they violated the 100,000 euro insurance level. It's like the insurance level at our bank's 250,000. Depositors, small depositors, are insured up to 100,000 euro in the euro system, and this wealth tax, this confiscation, is impacting them too. And I think that's a big mistake.
So one of the things that we're tracking here is the possibility that the bailouts are clearly out of room at this point in time. Germany, for a variety of reasons, perhaps not having a lot of sympathy for the particular investor class in Cyprus, but Germany seems to be out of patience for sending their savings to the southern zones. And Cyprus was small enough, I thought they thought they could ring fence it and try this out. But if it turns out that there's a jumping of attitudes across the borders, potentially people, investors might think, well, why would I keep my money in an Italian bank or a Portuguese bank or a Spanish bank? And those are all good questions, because to me, there's a lot of insolvency that's just very obvious. You just a crayon and a napkin, and you can figure out how insolvent some of these countries are. And the only way that that gets undone is through very rapid return to economic growth. We don't have anything in place that's going to give us that. So there's this chance for systemic risk. And I go through all of this, John, because in my world, I found that the price of gold correlates best with financial uncertainty and as an inverse function, and a little bit less so with inflation. How do you see the price of gold going forward, given, you know, all the effects of QE, but inflation is muted, but still we don't know if there's insolvent countries out there. Japan is printing. What are you looking at in the price of gold? Do you track that, and is that a part of the formulation?
What we track, what our primary metric is the real interest rate. What do you get on a risk-free return on your money after inflation? If you want total safety in your money, it used to be you put it in the bank, and I think it probably still is in the United States, you get an infinitesimal return. And if inflation is low, like currently 2% a year, it's still a negative return. You put $100 in the bank at the beginning of the year, you have $98 worth of purchasing power at the end of the year. And it's interesting, when the Cyprus thing came out, I started thinking about what kind of confiscation tax have people paid just by inflation over the last few years. And If you go back to when QE1 started in November of 08, and you roll the inflation numbers forward, the rate of inflation has been about 9% in the United States. So that if you had $100 in the bank in November of 08, you've got $91 worth of purchasing power now. $9 of your purchasing power has been confiscated by the government's inflation. So maybe we're just as bad off as the Cypriots are. We just don't realize it.
It's just they're doing it a little bit more above the table, and of course that's made people mad.
Quicker.
A little bit quicker and a little bit more certain what's happening. But you're absolutely right. So negative real interest rates do correlate very, very well with gold price appreciation. And so I guess this just feels like a perfect world to really support aggressive gold demand. And what I've been tracking, and it was Eric Sprott that brought this to my attention, was really the extraordinary mismatch between mining output and physical demand for gold that occurs each year. And that has to be made up from somewhere. And, of course, rising prices is part of that component. But still, the gold has to come from somewhere to make up that. Are you looking at overall supply and demand of gold as one of the leading indicators here, or is...
It's really on the demand side. You know, one thing that helps fill that match is scrap. People do scrap their gold. And whether it's from dead people's fillings or jewelry turned in or whatever, which is tracked by the World Gold Council, and those are the numbers we use. But there's a part of the demand that's not really studied enough in the States. We think that we're all centric about the United States. We think this is the hub of the universe. In the gold universe, the hub is China and India. And they represent over half the gold sales every year, half the demand. And, you know, and there it's particularly important to look at what their tax policies are, what their real interest rate situation. And in the last couple of years, the India-China has not been so favorable a situation for gold price. India has no gold mines, but it represents about 25% of gold demand. All gold has to be imported, and that wreaks havoc with their balance of trades. So the Indians try to slow down gold demand with an import tax and by making the price higher, but all that does is encourage smuggling, which doesn't really show up in the numbers. It's not tracked. And China's had its own issues with real interest rate. It depends where the inflation rate is and what their interest rates are. But the real interest rate in China was much higher a couple of years ago than it is now. And so, you know, you have to pay more. I think we as gold investors have to pay more attention to that half of the world, because it's that half, their half, the demand factors, and it's not just what happens between hedge funds in the United States or the UK that influences it. And I'm a big believer in the China surprise theory, that we're talking to the miners that we know that we cover that have Chinese mines. No gold that's mined in China leaves the country, and China is a gold importer. And so between domestic demand and hidden central bank demand, the Chinese central bank only reports its gold holdings every 5 years. The next potential reporting period is 2014, and that's not engraved in stone anywhere. That's just been their history. They could choose not to report in 2014. But if they do report in 2014, I think we're going to see a big jump from the roughly 33 million ounces of gold that they hold now in reserves, which is only about 1% of their total foreign exchange reserves, to, you know, something much more like 100 million ounces or something. All that gold that's going into China, coming from their own mines. They are the world's biggest mining gold producer. And the stuff that they import is going somewhere, and it's got to be going to the central bank reserves as well as people's, you know, wherever they keep their own gold.
Well, fantastic. It's absolutely a big story. We've been tracking that west to east flow, and it was a kind of an interesting tidbit. I'm sure you saw that the United States trade balance in the last reported month was a little bit better than expected, in part because about one point, if I have the number right, $8 billion in gold got shipped out. So there was even still, so it was enough to dent the U.S. trade deficit figure. And so gold has been flowing from west to east, and that's something we've been tracking as well. So we've been talking with John Doody of goldstockanalyst.com. And John, is there any other way that people would follow you or track you besides going to that site and checking you out?
Well, we're a subscription-based newsletter. We only get money from the subscribers. We don't get anything from the companies we cover. A little bit unique in the mm-hmm. mining business, mm-hmm. particularly the gold mining business. And we've been around since 1994. We have the only audited track record in all of newsletters, and it's all posted on the website, updated every year. And the sample issues on the website, we publish three newsletters, GSA Pro, GSA Top 10, which is by far the biggest one, and Silver Stock Analyst, which looks at a universe of 25 silver miners, all either miners now or near miners, in the sense that they've got a feasibility study that shows the ounces are really there and they're getting financing to go into production. And we do use the same metrics that we look at in gold: market cap per ounce of silver reserves, market cap per ounce of silver production, and operating cash flow multiples to figure out who's undervalued there as well.
Well, fantastic. I'm certainly intrigued, and I hope if anybody else is, you would go to goldstockanalyst.com, check it out, the GSA Top 10 Silver Stock Analyst, or maybe even the GSA Pro. That they all sound intriguing to me. I'm a fundamental guy at heart, so I love talking with somebody else who shares that view. I don't do any momentum trading or any chasing of trends or speculating. Just I love good hard numbers. Sounds like that's the work you're doing, so I'm a big fan of that. And John, really want to thank you for your time today.
Okay, well, great. It's great being on with you, Chris, and look forward to doing it again.
Fantastic. Me too.